Now we move on to module number 4, which is the improved phase of the DMAIC 6 Sigma methodology. So we have already covered the define phase, measure phase and analyze phase. So now we are moving into the improved phase. So by the end of this phase, you will be able to explain simple linear regression and discuss multilinear regression. So in improve phase, we are trying to take the improvement actions on a pilot scale and find out the solutions for the problems. So there are some statistical tools which are available for making the pilot improvements. So in this session, we will learn about some of those tools. So first we start with the tool that is simple linear regression. So in this session, we will be able to define correlation analysis, explain regression equation, and describe residual analysis. Okay, while we were learning about the measure phase, we saw the graphical techniques, that is the, and we learned about the scatter plots, right? Do you remember? Yes, scatter plots. So in scatter plots, what we are trying to do, we are trying to see whether there is a relationship between two parameters, two variables. So if there is an increasing trend, that's x increases, if y increases, then we call that as a positive correlation. Positive correlation. And if the relationship is very strong, then it will get a very sharp line like this, where this line will be, the points will be very sharp. Then we call that as a strong positive correlation. But somehow again, in some cases, we can just also get the positive correlation like this, where the relationship is not very sharp, we get like this. So here also, we see that as S is increasing, Y is increasing, but again, the relationship is not very strong. So we just called it as a possible positive correlation. Same way, as X is increasing, if Y is reducing, and then we have a sharp line, then we call that as a strong negative correlation. Again, if the relationship is not very strong, then we will get something like a blurred like this. We call it as a possible negative correlation. And it is also possible that sometimes there is no relationship between X and Y. So in that case, you can see that you will get something like this, images like this. So that means there is no relationship between X and Y. And also it is possible that there may be some other type of relationship. Here in this strong and positive, we have a linear relationship. That means as X is increasing, Y is either increasing or reducing, we call that as a linear correlation. Whereas in some cases, we can also find a sort of a curvilinear relationship also may be existing. So these are the possibilities. Whenever we are trying to find out whether there is a relationship between two variables, X and Y, the possibilities are either the relationship can be having a positive correlation or a negative correlation or a no correlation or a curvilinear relationship. Okay, so from the scatter plot, we will be able to know only that a relationship is existing or not. We will not be able to quantify the relationship. When we say it is strong, we don't know how much strong it is, and when we say it is weak, we don't know how much weak it is. So in order to quantify the relationship, then we have one measure which we call that as a correlation coefficient. So this correlation coefficient is an indication of whether what is the extent of relationship between two variables. So normally this type of correlations are found when the two variables are continuous variables. I think you remember what is the continuous data. It is the outcome of a measured data. Say for example, if you want to find out whether there is a relationship between the height and weight of boys, then height is measurable, weight is measurable, so both are continuous variables, and for this we will be able to plot a correlation graph, scatter plot, and then from the scatter plot you will be able to derive at what is the correlation coefficient. Okay, so the unit for measuring the correlation coefficient, we call that as a R. The correlation coefficient is indicated by small r. So small r means that is the correlation coefficient, and the value can vary between minus 1 and plus 1. That means r can take any value between minus 1 and plus 1 including 0. So if r value of minus 1 indicates very strong negative correlation. So when we saw here, whenever we are having a very strong negative correlation, then in that case r is equal to minus 1. Same way, whenever we are having a very strong positive correlation, then we have r is equal to 1. And whenever we have no correlation, or whenever we are having a curvilinear correlation, then we have r is equal to 0. So this type of possible negative correlation are the possible positive correlation, or the possible negative correlation will have somewhere between minus 1 and plus 1 values. So the correlation coefficient helps you to understand and quantify the extent of relations between x and two variables x and y. So here, do not get confused whenever I say, because normally in Six Sigma terminology we say x as input variables and y as output variable. So whenever I plot a graph here, x here and y here, so it is not necessarily that x is the cause and y is the effect. So whenever you are talking about correlation coefficient, you have to be very careful. Here these x and y are only independent variables, so we cannot establish a cause and effect relationship here. So when we are able to find out the relationship, this will give only an indication that these two are related. We will not be able to really pinpoint whether x is the cause or y is the cause, right? It will just give an indication that x and y are related. So this has to be clearly understood. In this session, we will learn about the regression equations, that too mainly under simple linear regression equations. So the simple linear regression model is also known as a straight line model. So it gives us a relationship between one y variable with one independent x variable. So the type of equation what we are trying to build up here, or the type of relationship what we want to build up here, is in the form y is equal to a plus bx, where a is the intercept and b is the slope. So for example, if you are trying to denote this is the x and this is the y, and then we are trying to find out a relationship like this. So here this intercept we call that as a, this is the intercept, and this b is the slope of this line. So whenever we are trying to establish a relationship between a single input variable and a single output variable, then we call that relationship as a simple linear regression. So let us take an example. So when we have a regression relationship. Just see an example here. A study was performed on wear of a bearing Y and its relationship to X1, that is the oil viscosity. So the following data were obtained. Fit a simple regression model to the data Y versus X1, considering alpha is equal to 0.05. So again, you are having here the data here. Y is the wear out of a bearing and X1 is the oil viscosity. So now you want to establish a relationship between these two variables. So whenever you just put this data into Minitab and then get the regression analysis, then the equation we are getting is Y is equal to 228 minus 2.86 into X1. So this is actually in the form A plus BX, where A is equal to 228 and B is equal to minus 2.86. So whenever we are trying to get a relationship between two variables Y and X in the form A plus BX, then we call that as a simple linear regression. So here we find that this X1, we are getting the p-value of 0.031. So since the p is less than 0.05, so that means this X1 is a critical X factor. Since p is less than 0.05, so the X1, that is the oil viscosity, has got a impact on the wear out of the bearing. So that is proved. And then here again we are getting the R square value as 65.7. So that means this indicates that about 66% of the wear out can be predicted by oil viscosity, or out of the total variation of the wear of the bearing, around 66% variation is being accounted for by the oil viscosity. So there is again another 34% we have to really see what are the other causes which is causing this 34%. So this regression equation says that 66% of the total variation is being caused because of the oil viscosity. So this is the inference we are getting by the simple linear equation. And then we also do a regression residual analysis. So whenever we are doing the residual analysis, we will just see the normality plot. So we will have to check whether the residuals are following having a normal distribution. Then whether the versus fits, whether we are having equal distributions above and below the middle line. So whether the graph with respect to the fits are randomly distributed above and below the middle line without any trend. So here we are seeing that all the points are distributed above and below the middle line without any pattern. So fits is also okay, normality is also there, histogram is also showing a normal distribution there. And then again versus R, so with respect to time also there is no visible pattern is there. So again here also the individual readings against time are also distributed randomly above and below the middle line. So that means the residual analysis is okay. So whenever we are considering a simple linear equation, there are three important points you have to see. Three important points. So if X1 is a critical variable, so then P has to be less than 0.05. So in that case, then X1 is a critical variable. So in our example, we got a p-value of 0.031, which is less than 0.05. So oil viscosity is a critical input variable. So that has been clearly established. Second important point is the R-square value. Since R-square value is for an ideal model, it has to be greater than 85%. But here we got only 66%. So that means the inference is that oil viscosity alone cannot be considered as the critical input. There are some other critical X factors also there. So we need to really search for the other critical input parameters which contribute for the variation in Y. So that means the conclusion is this: search for other critical X factors. So we cannot firmly conclude that only oil viscosity is related to the wear out. There are some other excess also which needs to be analyzed. And then third inference is we'll have to analyze the residuals. So doing the residual analysis, again we are finding that it is satisfying all the requirements. So this is residual analysis is okay. So the conclusion of doing this simple linear regression analysis is that other than accounting only for the 66% of the variation only, the other two parameters are met. That means the criticality of x1 is established and the residual analysis is okay. And R square value, since it is less than 85%, we will have to look for some other x critical x. So that is the inference we are getting from this simple linear equation. Okay, so whenever we are doing the regression, I told that there are two ways of checking whether the relationship, the regression equation, whatever you are getting is valid or not. One is the R square value greater than 85%, and second one is the P value for the individual excess should be less than 0.05. And there is a third requirement, or what we call it is a residual analysis. So that is also important. So what is the residual analysis? Or what is the residue? So whenever say we are trying to build up a regression, what we are trying to do, say for, suppose the points may not exactly fall in a straight line, okay? Suppose you are trying to find out the relationship, so I'm trying to plot the scatter plot, so the points will be like this. So whenever we are trying to fit a regression line, the software will look to just say what is the best possible line that can be drawn. Right, you know that all the lines cannot pass through this line, so it will just try to do some calculation and try to ensure that the best fitting line is obtained. Okay, so if you take at this point, this is the x and this y, and suppose now you just see this is the x value, this is the x, this thing. So at this, the actual value measured of y, suppose if it is 10, but the regression equation is going to tell maybe it's only 9, right? So there is a difference, right? Because this regression line is not passing through the this particular point. Only thing it is the best fit line which is possible, which is fitting most of the points for which the data is available. So we cannot say that this line, this equation is 100% correct. So then whatever the difference between the actual value and the expected value. So this is the actual value is 10. So the difference between actual value and the expected value, we call that as a error, or we call that as a residue. Okay. So if these residues are large, then what does it mean? So that means the equation, regression equation may not be very much accurate, because the approximation has gone to a very great extent. So if the residues are very less, so that means the equation is more reliable. So we'll have to do an analysis on the residues. So that's what we call it as a residual analysis. So this is also an important action you need to take while we are analyzing the validity of the regression equation. So here, say suppose here regression model, if says y is equal to yi plus ei, where y is the observed response and yi is the expected response and e is the error or residual. So in while we are doing the residual analysis, what we check? The lack of fit. Lack of fit means, so if it is exactly fitting, that means the particular point should lie exactly on the regression line. If it is not fitting, so that means the point is not lying exactly on the line. So how far it is varying? So this fit will give you what is the distance it is deviating from the line. And then random error. So random error is the error in estimating y caused by random variability in x for a fixed value of x. Because what happens is, whenever you are collecting the data, and suppose you are having three variables, x1, x2, x3, and then you are trying to find measure y. Suppose you just repeat the trial three times, and then you are trying to find out the value of y. So first time you may get say value of 10, second time you may get a value of 10.7, third time you get a value of 9.3. Okay. When you are setting x1, x2, x3 in the same settings, you cannot get the exact value for y in all the three equations. Why? Because there may be some errors in the experiment. We call that as an experimental error. So we also call that as a random error. Why? Because we know that there are, in addition to these three variables, there are some more causes which can be controlled or which cannot be controlled. So that will also will contribute to this variability. Right, so that is the reason we have identified only three, but maybe x4, x5 is also existing. So we don't know whenever we are doing the experiment whether x4 and x5 also are in the same level. Whenever you are doing these three trials, we do not know. So that is the reason when there is a difference is there. So this difference we call this a random error or a random error or a experimental error. So whenever we are doing the regression, we also do the residual plots, which include the histogram, normal plot of residuals, residual versus fitted value, and residual versus run order. So what we are doing, so whenever we are doing this regression in Minitab or any statistical software, we get these four type of plots. So what we need to check, the normal probability of plots. So whenever you are plotting the residuals, so standardized residuals, whenever you are plotting this curve, then this should be have a normal distribution. The residual should be normally distributed. So you just check whether the p-value is greater than 0.05. So if the p-value of the normal plot is more than 0.05, so that means the residuals are normally distributed and the regression equation is good. So whenever we are just checking for the fits, so fits means what? Say for example, now we are having the points like this, we are doing this regression, we are collecting the data, it is like this. So what we are trying to do, whenever we are trying to fit the best possible fit, so we will just try to look for a line where the points are above and below, right? We cannot say that, okay, we cannot plot a line like this and then say that this is the best possible, because here all the other all the points are in one direction, right? One region. So it cannot be, it can never be the optimum line. So if there is an optimum line, what happens is there should be some points above this line and there should be some points above below this line. So that's what we are trying to check in the versus fit. So in this versus fit, we should see points which are randomly distributed above and below this line. So if the points are distributed, and there should not be any pattern. So there should be a constant variance. It should not be like, it should not be increasing, or it should not be decreasing, or it should be all the points are available in one region. If those type of trends are available, so that means this is not right. So here we find that the points are randomly distributed equally above and below the middle line. So that means the residuals versus fit is right. Same way for the versus order. Here also the points should be like random, there should not be any pattern which is seen. So that should be randomly distributed above and below. So versus order is also right. And the histogram should be normally distributed. There should not be any outliers, or it should not be skewed to one direction. So this is also right. So we have to check for all these four parameters whether they are right. We have to check whether R square value is greater than 85%, and should check whether P is less than 0.05. If all these three conditions are met, so that means the regression value is valid, and whatever the critical excess are identified, that can be taken to the next stage for improvement. So in this session, you learnt about the correlation analysis and regression equations.